Odontoid fractures are relatively common fractures of the C2. It can be seen in the elderly group of patients with a low energy trauma or younger patients, but they have to have like a high energy trauma. I am Mohamed Raz, and this is your knowledge platform about the brain, spine, and beyond. The usual story that you get about C2 fractures is an elderly patient who fell off the stairs drunk on a Saturday night. The fracture is usually happen as a result of flexion or an extension injury, which can be associated with an anterior or posterior displacement. The degree of that displacement relies on the amount of ligamentous injury. The odontoid fracture can be classified according to Anderson-D'Alonzo classification, which is the most commonly used. And this is classified according to the site of the fracture. So with this one, you can see is just around the tip. That would be type 1 odontoid fracture. If it goes through like the waist of the C2, just at the bottom of the odontoid, which is this one, which would be type 2, and type 3, where it goes through the body of the C2 at the lower edge of the odontoid. So that would be type 3 fracture. Patients would usually present with neck pain, and they might have some neurological deficit, but this is usually unlikely. But if it happens, it means that they might have had a very serious injury to their neck. The imaging that can be done for patients with odontoid back fracture, definitely you can do an x-ray in an open mouth view. As you can see in this picture, you can see the C2 odontoid, and you can see there is a fracture line going through the odontoid. I mentioned in my previous video, which is unrelated to the odontoid, but basically the C1, C2 overhang. So if you haven't watched it, that you can watch that through the link above. Also, those patients would likely get a CT scan in the A&E, and they can sometimes, you can ask for an MRI scan if you want to assess the ligamentous injury, which, as we mentioned that multiple times in my previous videos, mainly to assess any ligamentous injury. Treating the patients with odontoid peg fractures is likely to be conservative with collar immobilization. Again, that's kind of a question at the moment with some of the trial going on, clinical trials, trying to see even if a collar is needed, because that group of patients are likely to be an older group of patients, usually 80s or above, and a lot of the time they are not compliant with using a collar. So if those trials might end up coming up with a decision to say, okay, you know, the collar might not be needed as well. But for the time being, we treat most of those patients with a collar. In a very small group of the patients, which is like type 2 fractures, where they have some neurological deficit, you might consider some surgical intervention. In this can be in the form of, as you can see, C1, C2 fixation, or sometimes you can use the odontoid peg screw, which basically goes from all the way from here all the way through the odontoid peg to fix those points together. And this is like a lag screw, so it has part which is serrated and a part is not serrated. And you can see in this image, they probably used a bit of cement as well. One other option to treat those patients in a halo, which would, you know, avoid having surgery like that, if that deemed feasible in that group of patients. The question here is why type 2 fracture is usually the only one that might require surgical intervention. And the reason is because the type 2 fracture is the one that with the highest ratio of having a non-union, with an overall incidence about 35%, especially in patients older than 40 years old, or if there is some posterior displacement more than 2 millimeter, or if there is an angulation more than 10 degrees. But the question is why type 2 specifically, that would be the one that have a higher rate of non-union in comparison to type 1 and type 2. And that takes us back to the vascular supply of the odontoid and odontoid peg. As you can see from this picture, here is the blood supply going to the odontoid. And there are some branches coming from here, coming from the internal carotid artery, which supplies a bit of the tip of the odontoid. Also, there are some other branches coming towards the from the vertebral artery here towards the base. And basically that creates a watershed or a gray zone here, which is not supplied properly by the blood supply. And basically that's why this specific area would get a non-union, which is in correlation with a type 2 fracture. Let's have a look on some of the imaging. So as you can see here, this is a sagittal view of cervical spine. And as you can see here, there's a clear line of fracture through the odontoid peg. And that's probably as in with the classification, as I said earlier, that's probably a type 2 fracture. And if we check this other patient, this is a coronal view. And as you can see, this is a line of fracture that goes all the way through. And that's probably extending towards the body, as I said earlier, and that's type 3. If we go through the scroll through the image, you can see the degree of the fracture through the odontoid and the body. Again, through this sagittal image, you can appreciate here that's more severe injury because of the gapping in between those, or the displacement between both. And also, if you look here, that there is a bit of angulation of this part of the odontoid on the rest of the C2 body. I hope you enjoyed this video and stay tuned for the next one.